HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Tickled, a Common Sense Guide to the Present Moment by Duff McDonald, read by Sean Pratt. For Joey, you were right. For the lady, you are magic. You are possibility itself. Thank you for your love. For Bob, thank you for your multitudes. For J.K., thank you for reintroducing me to my daughter. For J.C., thank you for reintroducing me to my brain. For Hugo, thank you for helping me say what I was trying to say. For Hollis, thank you for believing in me. For Betty, thank you for Joey. For now, because now is all there is. Not yet tickled. How did those priests ever get so serious and preach all that gloom? I don't think God tickled them yet. Beloved, hurry. St. Teresa of Avila, 1515 to 1582. Chapter 0. It is the greatest of lies that we are mere men. We are the God of the universe. Swami Vivekananda. I am going to begin this book in a way that's probably a little different than most books you've read. It's certainly different than any book that I've written. What I'm going to do is tell you about the book that I had every intention of writing but didn't end up writing. It was about a subject so perfectly suited to what I believed to be my core talents and strengths that I thought it would turn out to be the best thing I had ever created, the pinnacle of my career, what it had all been leading up to. My publisher agreed with me, and, armed with a sense of optimism and a generous advance, I sat down in May 2020 to do just that. Nothing turned out the way I planned. The original idea, you might say, didn't tickle me anymore. I ended up writing something else entirely. Before I go into all the reasons why that happened, I want to let you in on the vision for that original book, because it's really important to understanding how I ended up where I did. Please don't think that I'm asking you to read something that didn't make the final cut, because it did. You're listening to it right now, and I still believe every single sentence you're about to hear. The difference is that I believe them on a much deeper level than I realized when I began to write, and because of that, I ended up writing a different book than I'd intended. So, here we go. This is how this book was supposed to go. Rather, this is how it went. I wrote this introduction before I realized what I was doing wrong. The precision paradox. How our obsession with measurement has led to the decline of common sense. There are two kinds of people in the world: those who think we can measure everything, and those who know that we can't. It's remarkable, terrifying even, that the former group, the one that has it wrong, has somehow wrested control of society's decision-making apparatus away from the latter. It's less remarkable that they've held on to it. If the people in charge think that measurement matters more than it should, then measurement will matter more than it should. We have handed too much control over our collective decisions to self-described experts who seek truth about vital matters of human importance in a place that it cannot be found, in the data. What do you get when you count something? A number, of course. What is contained in that number? Nothing but itself. Are numbers always right? Well, ask three people to count the number of logs in a woodpile. Person A: there are 200 logs in the pile. Person B: There are 198 logs in the pile. Person C. I don't have time to count them, so I will just average the first two guesses and call it 199. Is it possible that one of those numbers is right? Yes, it is. Is it possible that all of those numbers are right? Of course not. Is it possible that none of them is right? Absolutely. Especially considering that the third person didn't even bother to look for the answer on their own and tried to get at it via mathematics, by averaging two data points, instead of seeking to experience it, that is, to count the logs directly. So, to summarize, a number may or may not contain truth. It depends. Not only that, we all know that the person doing the counting, of anything really, wields enormous power in setting the terms of a discussion and the apparent importance of that number, even though they may have no clear purchase on truth itself. Everyone wants to be right. So it's an understandable inclination to want to suggest that one's facts come carrying the weight of truth, even when the facts are wrong. We all do it, all the time. But here's the problem. Somewhere along the way, we began to confuse and conflate purported facts and truth. And then, over time, we came to believe, on a very deep level, that numbers were no longer just pointing to facts, but pointing at truths. Not only that, we gave them seniority over words as well. Some people deal with actual people and actual things. Let's call them specialists. And then there are those who deal with the data that we generate to try to keep track of those things. Let's call them experts. In other words, specialists deal with reality, and experts deal with models of reality. Look, I know there are other kinds of experts, but if you open any newspaper in 2021, when they say expert, they are really talking about analysts. Analysts count things. Think about that for a second. In 2021, you get to call yourself an expert if you spend your time counting things. Three-year-olds know how to count, but it takes someone who knows how to use their words to help a three-year-old understand what they are counting. The counters want to measure and rank everything. Are more people dying here or in Europe? What is the cost of all this death? Which is the most expensive virus in history? What does that poll say about that number? I'm not just talking about COVID either. I'm talking about everything. The reason that we can't stop counting is that counting is easier than understanding. But truth hides in the essence of a thing. If all we want to know is how many of something there are, then counting usually does the trick, provided that we can first agree on what we're counting and then come to some agreement about the count itself. But when the question isn't how many, but why, it doesn't matter how often you update your totals. They won't be able to answer your question. The only thing that numbers contain is themselves. There is nothing else there. And still, we keep trying to measure and count our way to answers about things that cannot be quantified. What is the worth of a human being? The experts tell us to evaluate each other based on the numbers that can be assigned to us. Our annual sales performance, our IQ, or our influencer rating. But such numbers can't get anywhere close to telling us who we really are or anything at all about those things that make us human, such as our level of awareness and our attitude, or, put another way, our state of being. It is only through awareness of your existence that you are ever going to get to truth or absolute reality. But there is nothing precise about awareness. It just is. Because awareness is not a thing of thought, it cannot be comprehended by any mental process. It lies entirely outside the domain of the intellect. We are in the grip of a misguided obsession with the precision offered by numbers and a quantified worldview. For the most part, that precision is a mirage. There are some things about which we can be very precise. Our height, our age, the number of fingers on each hand, or the total number of people in the room. There are others about which we cannot. Intuition, mood, harmony, or the reasons that people do the things they do. And once you measure one thing, as the theoretical physicist, Werner Heisenberg, would tell you, you've given up context. When you pin down location, you lose your hold on velocity. And when information becomes decontextualized, understanding bleeds away. When did this happen? The Czech economist Tomáš Sedláček has an idea. Perhaps the most important characteristic of the modern era has been the change in emphasis from the question why to the question how, he writes. This shift is, so to speak, from essence to method. The scientific era has tried to demystify the world around us, to present it in mechanical, mathematical, deterministic, and rational garments, and to get rid of axioms that cannot be empirically confirmed, such as faith and religion. The shift from why to how is also what happens to most people as they age. Children want to know why. Adults want to know how. Social scientists are particularly culpable of trying to quantify the unquantifiable. In a grab for respectability a century ago, they dressed themselves in the garb of scientific method, and we've been listening to nonsense about percentages of teamwork and average estimates of optimism ever since. Why do we not stop and address the sheer absurdity of these measurements? Because we are too busy trying to count our way to enlightenment. But the answer to the mystery of existence is not a number. Nor, for that matter, is the answer to the mystery of COVID. If you simply count what is happening with COVID, all you are doing is describing the surface. That's missing the point. No one needs to be told what this virus is. It's a killer. What's more, all the experts seem to be doing is telling us what is happening. How many infections here, how many deaths there, how the virus appears to be transmitted. The answer that we should be aiming for is why this is happening, because that's the only way we can get to a meaningful decision, not just about how to react to it, but about what we might do to prevent it from happening again. We need to ask why so that we can understand, and not just describe what is happening to us. We already know what is happening, and despite a staggering amount of expert advice, we have shown ourselves to be woefully incapable of understanding it. But this book is not about COVID-19. It's about something much bigger than that. It's about miracles. What is the most miraculous thing that ever happened? For each and every one of us, miracle number one is that we exist. Without that miracle, there is nothing. So existence is the thing. But here's the thing about existence. You can't count it or quantify it. It just is. It's also ever-changing. Existence is flux. There is not and never will be anything precise about being alive, and yet we count and count and count away. What are we at risk of losing? What have we already lost? Nothing short of our humanity. Man invented numbers, and intoxicated with that creation, man wants to measure everything, up to and including trying to calculate essence itself. Put differently, drunk in our success at building machines, we have begun trying to build technologies of the soul, and we are risking our souls by doing so. I am not interested in rehashing the age-old debate of quality versus quantity. What I am interested in is the paradox at the heart of modern life. Everyone can agree, for example, that it would be better to be happy than to be rich. But our obsession with measurement has led us to try to count quality itself. The most recent incarnation of such? The utterly absurd science of happiness, and the vast industry dedicated to the quantification of something as unquantifiable as contentment. We are trying to use measurement to answer questions including, who am I? Why am I here? What makes me happy? The more we try to measure our way to answers to those questions, the less we will ultimately know about our true nature. There are simply far too many moving parts, or variables, that cannot be accommodated when we try to calculate our way to a conclusion. There are too many aspects of humanity, about what we value and about things we cannot control, to try to jam it all into a formula. If we want the answer to all answers, we will need to step back from the measurements we have chosen to rely on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.